Simon & Schuster Audio presents 1 Week to Change the World, an oral history of the 1999 WTO protests by DW Gibson, read by Cassandra Campbell, Danny Campbell, Ramón de Ocampo, Jason Culp, Soneela Nankani, Leon Nixon, Fred Sanders, and Jackie Sanders.
For MJ Sieber and Mike Tryon, thank God you're still around. And in memory of Sanjay Iyer and Terry Guerin, I miss you every day. Each person is characterized by their role or position in 1999. Brief bios can be referenced at the end of this audiobook. Before.
Lori Wallach, director of Global Trade Watch. The fight was over the World Trade Organization.
Julia Hughes, vice president of the United States Association of Importers of Textiles and Apparel. A large part of establishing the WTO in 1995 was to create a participative, consensus-based international organization, not unlike the United Nations. It was created to establish rules of the road for international trade and to have a way to enforce those rules when countries go rogue.
Pascal Lamy, EU Trade Commissioner. The WTO, like many other international organizations, has always been about the acceptance of reduced sovereignty in the name of the common good. Something like, given the problems we all have, I accept that we constrain my country's sovereignty in the name of global benefit.
Victor Minotti, Program Coordinator for the International Forum on Globalization. The WTO was there to move power from the local and national level into a set of global rules written by the world's largest corporations at the exclusion of civil society. That raises concerns for a lot of people.
John Nichols, reporter for The Nation. It was establishing the ability to supersede and effectively overrule what the nation-state might do. So even if you won the legislative battle at home, you could be overridden at the global level.
Lori Wallach. The rules being written were things like, you can only have this much food safety, anything higher is a trade barrier, or this labeling system you have, it's an illegal trade barrier, or you can't have this kind of investment rule, you can't regulate services. All of it is viewed by the WTO as illegal trade barriers.
Deborah James, organizer for Global Exchange. People didn't realize that under the rules of the WTO, it's illegal to ban products based on production methods. One of the only things you're allowed to ban is prison labor. But if you say, we don't want these products in our country because they're made under exploitative conditions, or because they're made in ways that damage the environment, it's actually illegal to say we don't want those products circulating in our country. We were telling people this in 1999, and they'd say, well, we should be able to decide those things. And we were saying, yeah, that's why we don't like the WTO.
Celia Alario, Media Liaison at the Independent Media Center. People were seeing the ways in which everybody was affected, no matter what issues were important to you. The environment, human rights, social justice, sweatshop issues. This unchecked globalization and trade was going to affect all of us.
Lori Wallach. It was a battle of ideology. One was a vision of a single constitution for global corporate governance, which is what the first director of the WTO had said was needed. The alternative was making trade rules for countries according to what was interesting to their people and their governments, rules about what they would do when they decided to trade, not one-size-fits-all, top-down corporate dictates.
Ralph Nader, founder of Public Citizen. There is no such thing as a free market. Can you have a free market when you have monopolistic practices? Can you have a free market when you have big business subordinating small business in all kinds of ways? One-sided franchise agreements? Can you have a free market when you have corporations who often love intricate regulations? Not very onerous, mind you, but intricate, and they have the accountants and lawyers to do the work of compliance? Small businesses can't afford that, so they go out of business. Large corporations have propagandized the innocent and the ignorant in our society into accepting the idea of free markets. That's the way they legitimize what they do.
Colin Hines, founding member of the International Forum on Globalization. Margaret Thatcher's most corrosive four-letter word, TINA, there is no alternative, was totally absorbed by not just the status quo people who did well out of it, but also by the intellectually lazy who just said, well, you know, globalization's like gravity.
Celia Alario. We were being told the train had left the station. There is no turning back. This is the way the world is going to be. Vandana Shiva, founding member of the International Forum on Globalization. We realized if we don't tell our plural stories, what happened to Indian farmers, what happened to the Southeast Asian countries, what happened to Africa, we will get the typical story of all boats rising. And all boats weren't rising. Some boats were actually sinking.
Julia Hughes. The creation of the WTO wasn't the end of the job. Processes needed to be put in place that would help bring people together. So, built into the creation of the WTO was the concept of the ministerial. Talking about ministers is more European speak. The WTO is, after all, based in Geneva. We don't use that phrase here in the U.S. We have a U.S. trade representative, and that person's equivalent in other countries would likely be a trade minister. Most other countries around the world use that title, minister. So the conferences, which are usually every 2 years, are called ministerials. And the idea of the ministerial is to force countries face-to-face to discuss issues, to keep governments engaged and not just have the Geneva-based community, which is an incestuous thing, the Geneva crowd, making all the decisions. The idea behind the ministerials is to make sure home capitals and officials are also engaged. The objective going into the 1999 ministerial was to expand on the original framework that was set up 4 years earlier.
Tete Hormiku, coordinator of the Africa Trade Network. By 1999, African civil society organizations like ours had come to be very, very unhappy with the way the WTO was evolving. We discovered that the original agreements that were signed were problematic, to put it mildly, especially for Africa. But also at that point, the big countries, the European Union, Japan, Canada, and the U.S., the Quad, were hell-bent on expanding the agenda further. So we were opposed to the agreement that was signed already, and even more opposed to the effort to expand the agenda. David Solnit, co-founder of Art and Revolution. At the beginning of 1999, when we heard that the WTO ministerial was coming to the U.S., I thought, okay, this is our chance to step up, like the Zapatistas did, like people in Africa and other parts of the world have.
Lori Wallach. It was either going to be in Seattle, San Diego, or Honolulu.
Ron Judd, president of the King County Labor Council. I had a dream about WTO coming to Seattle. People thought I was crazy. Everybody goes, how do you know that? I go, just what my gut tells me. Here's my conclusion. And I walked them through my assessment of why everybody just loves free trade in Washington State, from our congressional delegation to our statewide elected leaders to all of our local, regional, urban leaguers, right down to the county commissioners. Per capita, we're the most trade-dependent state in the country. The meetings were going to be between Thanksgiving and Christmas, so the common view was no one's going to show up to protest. All they're going to do is cut ribbons and celebrate how good free trade is and use Washington and Seattle as the symbol of that. I said the great thing is they don't know we're going to plan something that's going to shock the shit out of them.
Colin Hines.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.